Hachette Audio presents Aftermath, written and read by LeVar Burton.
For my wife, Stephanie, who is my beloved and my best friend, and has always got my back. For my children, Ward and Michaela, may they never be afraid to be exactly who they are. Most of all, for my mother, Irma, who gave to me her love for the written word and taught me how to dream. Author's note. There have been significant changes, both positive and negative, in America since this novel was first published in 1997. Most significantly, at that time, I held neither hope nor belief that there would ever be a black president in this nation, at least not in my lifetime. So the election of Barack Obama as president of the United States in 2008 produced in me the feeling that this country had indeed reached a turning point in the fundamental issue America has grappled with since its inception, the all-encompassing, pervasive, and endemic institutionalized racism that has been baked into our social structures since the founding of these United States, were mitigated by the civil rights movement of the 60s, yes. However, I harbored no illusions that America was anything close to post-racial, as many trumpeted at the time. The fundamental flaw embedded by our founding fathers in the document that defines this nation has plagued America for the past 200-plus years. By affixing their signatures to the Declaration of Independence on that sweltering summer's day in Philadelphia, the founding fathers doomed Americans of African descent to live for generations lives of state-sanctioned terror. After all, by creating a constitutional federal democracy which claims that all men are created equal, is in direct opposition to the enshrinement of chattel slavery, the most cruel and inhumane treatment based on color, as a cardinal component of its identity. More recently, with the election of Donald Trump as president in 2016, little did we know that his single term in office would result in his purposeful fanning of the flames of some of the ugliest aspects of our American character. The damage he has inflicted on the nation is considerable, and some of the measures undoubtedly inspired by him have already led to dire and dangerous consequences. Not since the Jim Crow era have we seen the willful and wanton rolling back of the civil rights of those of African, Hispanic, Asian, and indigenous heritage, as well as poor people and those who have been marginalized in our society. America, instead, has been obvious and consistent in denying her minority populations the rights and privileges given freely to her Caucasian population. Throughout the whole history of our nation, there have been two Americas. One with a different set of rules for the majority white population, while those who have been traditionally othered by the majority have been relegated to a different and, in many cases, a substandard version of the American dream in areas such as housing, education, and healthcare, to name just a few. Also, there has been an historical disparity in how minorities are treated by the law enforcement community in this country, and even those who continue to be committed to denying this reality are being met with evidence of such treatment that has been captured and broadcast. Incontrovertible proof, evidence of what the reality of many has been all along. Like it or not, this nation's demographics are changing. In just a few short years, the majority population will, for the first time in its history, be Hispanic, not Caucasian. Which means that the majority population will be brown people, not white. The majority will have become the minority, and the balance of power in the electorate will also shift. Given our history, I suspect there to be some resistance to this inevitable shift. The nature, and most importantly, the degree of that resistance, undoubtedly will have a major impact on the next chapter of the American story. One final note. I invite you, dear listener, to observe how some of the predictions made in the chronology of events, which are designed to set the context for the narrative, seem eerily prescient. Over the years, I have sometimes been astonished by the similarities between my timeline and unfolding events. You may well be too. However, I wrote this novel as a cautionary tale, a piece of post-apocalyptic fiction, and as we all know, the truth can sometimes be stranger than fiction. Is there any possibility that this experiment called democracy will ever realize its promise, that all of us are indeed equals entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Who knows? Certainly not I. However, I do know this. The answer most likely will be found in an evolution out of our penchant desire to dominate the other, that ruthless greed and a lust for wealth and power must give way to an ethos based on compassion, that E pluribus unum is more than simply a slogan inked on our currency. By remembering that the few are worthy of all the benefits that come with being an American. Further, it is the responsibility of the many to ensure that those rights guaranteed in our Constitution are enjoyed by us all. And when the many become the few, may they enjoy the fruits of the American experience unbound in any manner contrary to the way those fruits were consciously and continuously denied to those on the opposite side of the color line. LeVar Burton, May 2021. Chronology of events leading to the war of 2015 to 2018. 2009. America launches space station Alpha. Built and supplied by numerous shuttle launches, the space station houses a crew of 60 scientists and engineers. It is a proud day for the United States, but there is considerable grumbling among members of Congress about the cost of the project. Many think the money could have been better used to provide services for the country's growing number of homeless. Elsewhere in the world, skirmishes, minor wars, droughts, famines, and overpopulation have brought the global economy to the brink of disaster. Struggling with its own financial problems, the United States can no longer provide financial assistance to other regions. 2010. Senator Lawrence Everett, a black Democrat from Ohio, announces his bid for the presidency. An outspoken advocate of racial equality, he vows to increase spending for the homeless and needy, rebuild America's inner city areas, and end the stranglehold big business has on government. Although his plans don't sit well with those already empowered in Washington, he proves to be a popular choice with the people and soon leads the race. 2011. NASA atmospheric scientist Leon Kane publishes a report in Scientific American linking the space program to violent weather patterns throughout the world. His article creates a national scandal, causing Congress to stop all NASA funding and ground shuttle launches until a solution to the problem can be found. 2012. Lawrence Everett is elected President of the United States. 4 days later, he is assassinated by a white extremist in a chemical bomb attack. Riots break out in Los Angeles, Miami, New York, and Atlanta. The U.S. government responds by sending in the National Guard. 2013, May. The New Madrid Fault in southern Missouri shifts, causing an earthquake of 9.1 magnitude. St. Louis and numerous other Midwestern cities are destroyed. Thousands are killed, millions left homeless. The United States government is slow in responding to the situation in the Midwest, which leads to rioting and looting. The cry of "Remember Everett" becomes the official anthem of the poor, the homeless, and the oppressed. In an attempt to stamp out the flames of revolution, the government sends federal troops into the area. November. Tensions reach an all-time high as winter sets in. Millions of people are still homeless. Many more lack food, fresh water, and the other basic necessities of life. St. Louis, Chicago, Kansas City, Nashville, and other cities erupt in fighting. Additional troops are called into these areas, but many minority soldiers refuse to fire on their own people. A rift develops in the military ranks. 2014. The nation teeters on the brink of civil war. More troops are called for, but the government no longer has the funds to supply them. Emergency food and relief efforts grind to a halt as funding runs out. Numerous insurance companies file for bankruptcy. July 8th, the stock market crashes. Thousands of banks fail. Many more are forced to close their doors, declaring a bank holiday to prevent customers from making massive withdrawals. The U.S. economy fails, and the country enters another major depression. Stranded since shuttle launches were halted, with little hope of coming home, the crew of Space Station Alpha begins to fight. A fire is started, which escalates in the oxygen-rich atmosphere. Millions watch at home, horrified, as all those aboard the space station die. NASA collapses, and with it dies the dream of space exploration. 2015. In a last-ditch effort to prevent a possible race war, General Wyatt Dixon, one of America's most distinguished black officers, attempts to seize control of the army. His efforts fail, and the United States military splits in half, with minority soldiers lining up behind Dixon. Fighting breaks out on military bases around the country. For the first time since the Civil War, American soldiers are fighting one another. The public school system fails, Social Security and welfare fail. 2015 to 2018, race war. Millions die, millions more are left homeless. Food shortages, nationwide famine, widespread disease.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.